Good morning, everyone. Welcome. We're glad that you're here to worship with us today. If you would, let's stand together. And as we get ready to stand, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your kindness. May you be glorified and lifted up above everything else today. May your name be honored. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
King of glory, the King of all of me. at least the calendar says it's spring. So I hope the weatherman reads the calendar. For me, hard work is very satisfying and is its own reward. I'm fond of the saying, the only place success comes before work is in the dictionary. Stephen King once said, talent is cheaper than table salt. What separates the talented individual from the successful one is a lot of hard work. And as Henry Ford said, the harder you work, the luckier you get. In Colossians 3, verses 23 and 24, the Apostle Paul writes, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. The Bible instructs us to work at spreading the gospel, the good news, so that others might be saved. Matthew chapter 9 tells us that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. It's important for us as Christians to work hardest on the things that are most important. In John 6, Jesus says, do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. In James 2 we read, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Faith without deeds is useless. As we prepare our hearts for communion this morning, my prayer is that we all work very hard at the things that are truly important in this life. In doing so, we will achieve success at growing in our faith, at knowing and following God's will for our lives, and at sharing the gospel. Please pray with me. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come together to fellowship with one another and to learn more about your will for our lives, and most of all, to worship you. We thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, the memory that we have of that, the communion service that we celebrate each Lord's Day to help remind us of that sacrifice and what it means in spending eternity with you. We'd ask that you would help us to recognize opportunities that are presented to us so often to share the gospel with those who aren't saved. And when we do recognize those opportunities, we ask that you would give us the strength to share the truth in love with others. I ask all these things in your Son Jesus' most precious name. Thank you.
us and you know us. Lord, we come before you now to give our gifts, a tithe and offering to you. Lord, may it glorify and honor your precious name. For in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Last week in the sermon, I stated that the only time I bring my cell phone mountain biking is if I bring it just so I can call somebody in case I get hurt or I can video Kyle getting hurt. I want you to know, I had nothing to do with this. I was not supposed to be in town. It had nothing to do with me, had nothing to do with mountain biking. What it did have to do is a little term in the dirt bike world called whiskey throttle. You know what I'm talking about? If they know what a whiskey throttle is, raise your hand if you know what whiskey throttle is. Just a few of them. That's a term that we'll explain to you real quick how it works. Say the bike is sliding up beneath you, you're hanging on to the handlebars, and you put your foot out to maybe catch yourself. You will immediately begin to fall off the motorcycle if you have a good grip. As you fall off, you will twist that throttle all the more, which will make things all the more worse. So that is what happened here, the definition of whiskey throttle. I did not video it. Somebody else did video part of it though, and I did see some of that stuff. Maybe we can clean that up and show that next week. But we did give Kyle a nice little lambskin cover for his sling here. That's from all of us here at Smithville. Appreciate you so much. Kids, sixth grade below, I've never done whiskey throttle, and you can go to children's church. What I noticed is those of you who knew what the whiskey throttle is, you kind of smiled like, yep, been there, done that. You know exactly what he's talking about. You love him all the more. We love Kyle. Hate to see him get hurt, though. He dislocated his shoulder. They got it back in place. He's going to give up, isn't he, Jenny? Is he going to be all right? Okay, great. Don't mean to violate Hitler or nothing like that. Just thought he'd probably get going on the right track.
Well, we better get to work here. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 13. As you're turning, I'll just remind you, it's March. And March is a wonderful time of year because the weather begins to bloom and warm and the grass turns green. So get those blades sharpened on the lawnmower. We're going to be cutting grass soon. Oh, that's bad news. Doug pointed out that Wednesday is officially the first day of spring. What happens in spring? Anybody? What happens in spring? What is it? Mushrooms. Anything else happen in spring? Your birthday! All right. Anything else happen in March that ends with Ness? Basketball! March Madness! It's here! Yes! The tournament comes out today. The brackets will come. Are we making the tournament? Who thinks we're making the tournament? Who thinks there's not a chance we're making the tournament? Somebody's like, we'll be in the NIT. Well, the NIT stands for not in tournament, okay? Just so you know. You know, with basketball madness all in the air, I had an idea this week, and I have this junk pile behind the barn that Aurora's real proud of. Not really. I hear about it every now and then. When are you going to burn that stuff? It's mainly wood. Well, I went in that junk pile, and I pulled out a piece of old plywood, kind of waterlogged and misshaped, and I pulled it out, and I showed Paul and Joel. I said, you know what this is, boys? And they go, well, a treehouse. I'm like, no, it's a basketball goal. They go, it is? I said, yes, it is. And so they went and they grabbed some spray paint and they began spray painting on it. And I helped them out a little bit. We made a camo IU basketball backboard and then went to town and got a rim. And not one of these breakaways, we got the old school fixed rim. No dunking, by the way. We don't want you breaking our goal. Next night, we sturdied it up in the back. I had some old more scrap lumber back there. Note to self, don't use the 2x10 on the back. It makes it really heavy and hard to hang, just so you know. Just remember that. So reinforced the back of it, and then Emily came out, and she helped us hang it, and we strung the net. It was just wonderful. It's a beautiful basketball goal. I mean, it really is. It even has Yogi's approval. Check this thing out. Isn't that awesome? Right there in the barn. It's a barn goal. Well, the kids are so proud of it, they went in the house and they got Aurora. I said, come out and see our basketball goal. And Aurora came out, she took the first shot, nothing but net. I mean, beautiful. This thing has favor already in it. And since it's been hung, every day we hear the beautiful sound of basketballs dribbling in the barn. They love it. Paul told me, he said, remember this, Paul? You said, people are going to come from all over to play on this goal and eat our deer sausage. I don't know how deer sausage got included in the basketball goal. We're not sharing all that, buddy. I must admit, I'm a little proud of it, too. You know, building that goal was wise and it was worth the work. Because not only is it just a fantastic goal, it is. If it was, it's only 8.5 feet. If it were 10, it'd be like the best goal ever. But it's a fantastic goal. And that isn't the only reason why I think it was worth building the goal. The other thing is I was teaching my kids how to work while we built the goal. Isn't that worth something? To teach your kids how to work? You know, as we continue in our study of Proverbs, we discover that wise work builds wealth. You ever see the infomercial and they say, order my kit and I'll make you a millionaire. Well, here you go. You want to know how to build wealth? It's spelled W-O-R-K. That's how you build wealth. Proverbs informs us that lazy people are soon poor, hard workers get rich. The soul of the sluggard craves and gets nothing, while the soul of the diligent is richly supplied. Forget for a moment what you think in regards to being rich and poor. Quit thinking about currency. Quit thinking about money for a moment and think about living. Just because somebody has a lot of money doesn't make them rich. I've known a lot of people that have a lot of money that are very, very poor. They're not enjoying life. Jesus said, I've come to give you a rich and satisfying life. And here's the thing about being rich or being poor. Poor is a frame of mind. It is. It's a frame of mind that's brought on by coveting and comparing what one doesn't have with what everybody else has. Oh, if I wish I had all theirs. Well, you have a lot. Well, not compared to them. How many of you had a hot shower in the last 2 days? The rest of you, we'll just pretend like you did. Is that a luxury? Is that a luxury that maybe a lot of the world did not have the opportunity to have? I'm telling you that because you're rich. See, poor is a frame of mind. Also, rich is a frame of mind. It's being satisfied with what one has worked for. Those who are rich have found contentment is the greatest wealth one can have. Next month, we're excited to host the Mountain Mission School Choir. How many of you remember us hosting it last time? Only like 5 of us, right? The church has grown a lot since then. And we're excited about this, so mark your calendars for April 7th, 6 p.m. That's a Sunday evening. You're going to come out, you're going to hear this choir. It's amazing. But Mountain Mission has a special place in my heart, probably more because that's where my dad was sent as a child. rather than their choir. I love hearing their choir. It brings me to tears, but when I hear Mountain Mission School, I think about my dad. My dad found himself on the streets when he was a kid, he and his little brother. And it was just an uncertain time, and they were pretty much homeless. They ran the streets. And if you remember the last time Mountain Mission came, Dad got up to spoke, and he couldn't even talk. He said, "What for Mountain Mission School, I'd either be dead or I'd be in prison." Mountain Mission School's more than a school. It's a children's home. It's an orphanage. And so my dad went to Mountain Mission School. He wasn't happy about it as a kid, but he went there, and while he was there, he was shown Christ's love when he wasn't so lovable. He was given an education. He was given a roof over his head, and he was given meals to eat. And you know what else? He was taught to work. Because kids at Mountain Mission, they have to participate in the work of the school. Well, when Dad graduated from Mountain Mission School, he knew that he was called to preach the Word of God. But he didn't have any money. So after he graduated, he went to Austin, Indiana, and he worked at Morgan's Packing Company. He saved up enough money to go over to Cincinnati for about a week, because there was a Bible college there, and he wanted to get into Cincinnati Bible Seminary. He went over to Cincinnati, and he found a real nice place. Maybe it wasn't real nice, but he found a room, $7 for 7 days, as in $1 per night. Think about that place. He also found a job. Once he found a job, he knew for sure they'd let him in the school because he had great academics. He went up to the school and said, "I've graduated from Mountain Mission School. I want to preach the Word of God. I've been called to preach the Word of God, and I've got a job." And they said, "Well, who's supporting you?" He said, "Well, I've got a job." They said, "Well, who's supporting you?" He said, "Well, I've got a job." And they said, "No money, no admittance." And they sent him away. I shouldn't have went there to get an education. I should have went somewhere else, you know? Well, Dad hitchhiked back to Austin. He didn't have a car. He continued to work at Morgan's. They said, "Johnny, you can have a job right here. You can stay and have a good career." He said, "Well, I'm called to preach the Word of God." He said, "Let me try something else." He got a bus ticket. He went to Kentucky Christian College in Grayson, Kentucky. When he got to Kentucky Christian College, he arrived. He had two pair of pants and two shirts. He had a little suitcase, no blankets. He said, "If you held a suitcase up to one end, you'd hear everything fall to the other." He covered up with a newspaper that first night, and then one of the other kids in the dorm felt sorry for him, invited him to stay in his room, and gave him a blanket to keep warm. He said, "Johnny, you're going to preach the Word. God's going to provide the way." Dad went to the missions office, and he said, "I'm here to preach the Word of God. I need to learn how to preach the Word of God. I want to be a student." They said, "Well, who's supporting you?" He said, "Well, I have a job. I'll support myself." They said, "No, who's supporting you? You don't understand how much money it costs to go to college." He said, I don't have anybody supporting me but me. No money, no admittance. They sent him away, but Dad didn't leave campus just yet. And on campus, he ran into a staff member named Jack Bliffin. He saw Dad on campus, and he took notice of him. He said, "Are you one of our new students?" He said, "I'd sure like to be, but they told me I couldn't because I don't have any support." Jack asked Dad if he knew how to work on a farm, and Dad said, "Well, yeah, I know how to work on a farm. I'd love to work on a farm. I need a job." Jack said, "Come up to my office." They got to the office. He gave Dad a time card. He said, "Johnny, go down to the hog barn and get to work. I'll go over to missions and let them know that you have support." Dad took care of the college farm at Kentucky Christian College. He served two churches while he was getting his education. He married the finest lady on campus, my mama. He was the seventh student in that school's history to earn their highest theology degree. When he graduated, Kentucky Christian College owed him $70 because he had worked so much. Dad has served 56 years in ministry. He and Mom have been married 53 years. Hard workers get rich. Oh, I didn't tell you about their bank account, did I? Well, that's nothing really to brag about, but they have enough. They get by. Well, it's enough. Enough's when you have a roof over your head and food to eat. See, having a Christian education, a loving wife, all right kids, that's being rich. I mean, in my dad's world, he's like, "Well, he didn't embarrass me too bad today. It's a good day, you know." didn't put one of those, as he says, stupid videos out there. We also find that when we work for it, we appreciate it. Nobody appreciates their education like my dad appreciates his. I mean, talking about a guy that had relationships with all of his professors all through life. His professors would come to our house and stay with us when they were in the area. Why? Because they knew he appreciated what they taught him, and he appreciated them, and they appreciated him as well. See, wise work, it builds wealth. It gives us ownership, doesn't it? My son Joel said, "Dad, our basketball goal is the best goal ever." See, Joel worked on that goal, and because he worked on that goal, he had ownership in that goal. And ownership made him see something that was built out of scraps as better than something that could be bought at a sporting goods store. I have a question. Do you believe we made that goal? Do you? I mean, you believe it because I told you we made it. I showed you some evidence that we made it. And the main reason you believe it is because you've never seen another one like it. Yeah, that's something that came out of East Olytic for sure. Now, if you came over to my house and you said, "You know, Stephen, I'm an expert at building basketball goals. I know exactly how to line a basketball goal out and know how they're put together. I understand everything about it, and I'm just going to tell you, I'm looking at that basketball goal," and you did not build that basketball goal. In fact, what happened is I heard about the recent tornado in this area this last week. And what happened in the midst of that tornado is that tornado spun all the materials behind your barn up in the air. And as it did it, it separated that piece of plywood and it deflated the paint cans just perfectly to make that beautiful camo and IU print on the backboard. And then there was a skill saw in your neighbor's junk pile and it shot into the air at such a velocity that it was spinning really, really fast. And as it was spinning, it cut up all those boards just perfectly. And as it was in the middle of the eye of the storm, the vortex of that storm just drove those nails right through that plywood and into those tubatins behind it. And as it was spinning in the air, it was suspended right perfectly in the corner, right where it needed to be, and still not blocking Yogi on the side of your barn. All the while, it just spun that lag bolt right through it and fastened it right to the wall. That's how that basketball goal was built. You guys didn't build that basketball goal. Well, if you said that to me and my kids, we'd say, "I don't think you've ever built a basketball goal, mister. No tornado built that basketball goal. We built that basketball goal." All right, the preacher's lost his mind. I don't think I'm the one that's lost my mind. Now let's go to God's Word. Because I think we forget who owns the work of this earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God said it. Look out for the window there. You see the evidence of it. And I guarantee you've never seen another like it. Thus, I believe God did in fact create the heavens and the earth. It baffles me that people are thought of as intellectuals when they teach theories that line up with tornadoes building basketball goals. That our planet came through some accidental cosmic collision. That our lives are products of evolution and that our ancestors are animals. Friends, forget the theories and let's stick with the truth. We're not on this world because of chaos. We were created. We were created by God, by a loving God. Our ancestors are not animals. Our ancestry goes back to Adam. God created human beings in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. And God saw everything that He had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning on the sixth day. Perhaps many want to leave the Creator out of the work of this earth, out of creation, because then we'll have to acknowledge that we are created, that we are formed, and that we are God's work. And since we are God's work, He owns us, and He, since He owns us, He rules us, and He calls us to live for the purpose that He put us here on this earth to pursue. We didn't build the barn goal for the goal or the barn's sake. Nor did we build it and hang it so somebody could hang tools on it and use it for some other purpose. We built it for a specific purpose. Nothing but net. To sink basketballs through that goal. To play basketball. Just the same, you are God's work. He built you. He created you. He formed you in your mother's womb for a very, very, very specific purpose. For we are God's masterpiece. That's the Word of God. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. If you don't hear anything else this morning, would you hear this? You are God's masterpiece. You, my friend, are His work, and you are beautiful. You are beautiful. You are loved. You have a purpose. You may think that your parents aren't proud of you, but I promise that the Creator is proud of you. That God is proud of you. He loves you and He thinks so much of you that He made a way for you to be perfect. Like, yeah, Stephen, he's one of my stupid kids. I love him though. And I'm going to make a way for him to be perfect. Perfect. How did He do that? His one and only Son went to the cross to take care of every one of my blemishes, every one of my imperfections, every one of my misdeeds, everything that I've messed up and that you've messed up. See, through the loving sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross, and since Jesus rose from the grave, we are perfected in Christ. So rise and live for the glory of God. Rise and live for the purpose that you were designed and built for. Since you've heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from Him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? For you do not even belong to yourself. For God bought you at a high price, so you must honor God with your body. The price paid for you was the hard work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And His work is to be respected. And if you believe in Jesus Christ and you put your faith in Him and you're setting your sights on Him, you are holy. And your holiness is to be respected. Nobody's to be talking to you like you're something that you're not. Some of us have been told we're stupid. Some of us have been told we're ugly. Some of us have been told we're fat and all these other things. I want to tell you, you're beautiful. And if you're in Christ, you're righteous and you're holy. And anything else that someone speaks to you is a lie from the pit of hell. My God formed you in your mother's womb, and He loved you, and He gave Himself for you. Wise work builds wealth, gives ownership. Wise work is to be respected. The work of God in your life is to be respected by you and by others. The work you do with your hands is to be respected by you and by others. On Friday night, Paul and I were playing a little game on our goal one-on-one, and I went up on a layup, and as I did, I think he says I touched the rim. I don't really think I did, but as soon as I touched the rim, it's only 8.5 feet tall. He said, "Hey, no dunking. You can't dunk on our goal." Now, if you remember back in the day when you built your own goals and you had fixed rims, there was absolutely no dunking. Somebody come over and started dunking on your goal, you correct them. Why? You didn't want them tearing up your work. Why was Paul correcting me? And just so you know, if you're one of those, that are, many that are going to come down and shoot basketball and eat deer sausage with us, no dunking. Why? We don't want you messing up our goal. We don't want you tearing down our rim. We want you to respect our work. One of my best friends growing up, he never had to work for anything. He hated coming over to our house because Dad always put us to work. Go feed the horses. Go get the hay. Go carry in the wood. Split the wood. He's like, we're not going to your house. Your dad will put us to work. I'm like, man, I need you to come over to my house. You can help me with the work. We'll go to my house. We'll play video games, he would say. Thing is I was used to working, and I got pretty bored watching him play video games. I didn't want any part of it. But anyway, as soon as he got his license, and he never worked for anything, his parents, they bought him a Camaro, and this thing was slick. It was a metallic blue. It was beautiful. Had the awesome aluminum wheels on it, the bigger tires in the back. This thing was beast. It was an awesome car. And ended up, that car led him to do the first work he ever did in his life. He cleaned out a fence row with it about 2 weeks later. Well, a few weeks after that, his parents bought him a new car because that would be safer. They had anti-lock brakes at this time coming out, so he needed one of those new cars with anti-lock brakes. Then he wouldn't have been cleaning out fence rows and stuff. So he got the new car and hit a deer with it. And then after it got repaired from hitting the deer, we were coming across I Street there off the square in Bedford. There was a carload of us. And I was like, don't do it, man, don't do it. I knew what he was going to do because he'd done it before. But he caught that green light. If you're on I Street, in front of a German-American bank, in front of the jail. You know what I'm talking about? You're laughing because you've been down that road and you've done it. Well, there's a little hump on I Street in Bedford. And if you hit that hump, what'll happen? If you hit it going good, what'll happen? Airborne! Yeah, Dukes of Hazzard. Yeehaw! Well, he caught that light just right, and he hammered down right in front of the police station, never slowed down. I don't know how fast we're going, but I'll tell you this. When we hit that hump, we were in the air. We could have cleared this part of the stage right here with me on it, and our heads were all smashed up against the ceiling of that Ford Tempo. He was over here hanging on the steering wheel, one hand on the wheel, one out the window going, yee-haw! Well, it landed. When it landed, that car bounced twice. He was laughing. He hit the gas, and nothing happened. The car was running, but whenever he landed, he broke every motor mount that was holding that engine in place, and it disconnected it from the drivetrain. But we were going fast enough that we coasted almost all the way to Tom's there back when it was on Fish Street. His dad said, what in the world happened? He goes, I don't know. It must have been those guys at Ford when they fixed it from hitting a deer. Got fixed again. He ended up rolling it about a month later. After that, they bought him an old $500 car. You know, what's funny is I drove a $300 truck. And many times he was in the passenger seat and said, hit it, hit it, hit it. And I was like, no way, man, my truck will fall apart. What was the difference? I'll tell you the difference. I threw bales of hay to buy my truck. I sold firewood to buy my truck, and I needed that truck to haul firewood. I worked for mine. His was given to him. Here's what I'm saying. Parents, when they work for it, they'll respect it a lot more than if you just give it to them. So let's quit giving our kids allowances that they don't earn. Oh, that's their allowance. What'd they do for it? Well, you know, it's their allowance. What'd they do for it? Well, it's their allowance. You know, it's their. No, that's a gift. That's a gift. It's not an allowance. See, an allowance is something you work for. Allowance is something you earn. So let's quit throwing the word allowance in there with gifts. It's okay to give your kids gifts. It's okay to let them feel special. That's good. But my goodness, don't make them dependent on you for life. Teach them to work. Make them earn something. Sometimes we give them vehicles. They don't even appreciate the vehicles. Why don't they appreciate the vehicles? Because they didn't work for them, just like my friend. Didn't work for it. He didn't appreciate it. You know, sadly, he never appreciated things till later on in life after he had to learn some really, really, really hard lessons. Because he didn't know how to take care of a vehicle. Why? Because he had never worked for a vehicle. He never worked for it, so he didn't respect it. And he didn't have any ownership into it. We need to teach them to work. Why do our kids often make messes all over the house? Well, I'll tell you the first reason is because they're kids. That's what they do. See, to you, a mess is like, oh my, a mess. I walk in, I'm like, look at this mess. The kid's like, yeah, I know. It took me all day to do this. They're like proud of the mess. They think that's their job is to get up in the morning and make a mess. I'll tell you when that changes. When you start making them help you out around the house and clean up the mess, that changes. Then when somebody drops something, they're like, hey, you need to pick that up. You spilt milk over it. You need to wipe it up. See, whenever we let them share in the work around the house, they begin to respect the work you've done in the house. But they won't respect it if you just keep on picking up after them and scolding them. Hey, don't do that. They don't care if you yell. That's another badge of honor. They get you to really lose it and yell real loud in the day they've succeeded. Yeah, do you see how fired up I got them? That's awesome. What am I saying? If we're not requiring our kids to work in the home, we're not doing them any favors. We're definitely not getting them ahead in life. See, the Bible has a term for those who don't work. You know what that term is? I love this word. The only time I ever see this word is in Scripture. The word for those who refuse to work in the Bible is sluggard. Sluggard. It just sounds lazy, don't it? Sluggard. Some of you are going to go to work tomorrow. Some of you are going to be pulling your weight. You're like, all right, sluggard. Here's something you can use after that. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. That's what the Bible says. Now, don't be quoting it at your coworkers. What's my point there? Let's get serious. The sluggard's lazy. The ant is a worker. The sluggard is destined for poverty, and the ant is destined for prosperity. What's the difference? The ant works and the sluggard's lazy. And so the ant appreciates his work, and sluggards don't appreciate anything but sleep and slumber and selfishness. Ants have ownership in things. Sluggards don't own anything. The ant's respected, and the sluggard is despised. Wise work builds wealth, gives ownership. It is respected. Wise work is knowledge. Wise work is knowledge. Would you believe me if I told you, I truly believe knowing how to work is as important as any degree that IU offers? Because it doesn't matter what degree you earn if you don't know how to work. Work is knowledge. Who teaches work? Who teaches? Whose job is it? I think it's the parents' job. I think it's the grandparents' job. I think it's the aunt and the uncle's job. I think it's the friend's job. I think just all the time making it to where these kids don't have to work, to where they just feel entitled to everything, we're not doing them any favors. We must teach them to work. All the teenagers in the room said, you just went to meddling, man. I'm not with you anymore. Now listen to this. You need to learn to work. And I think we have some kids that work really hard around here. I think we have some that need to improve on learning how to work. You know how I know? It's because of the way they respect the grounds. Some respect the grounds greatly. Some of them have no respect for the grounds. Why? Because they don't know how to work. And you're not going to learn to work by watching Netflix, even if it is dirty jobs. You're not going to learn to work by playing video games. You're not going to learn to work surfing the web. You can research it all you want. You can get everybody's opinion of it on social media, but that's not going to teach you how to work. Work is learned by showing and sharing. You have to show them how to work, parents, and then you have to let them share in the work. And you can show them how to work while they're sharing in the work. Surely somebody wants to say amen on that. See, I'm grateful that my parents gave me a PhD in hard work. And Aurora and I have decided, that it's time we step it up around our house. We really like to see our kids enjoy things, but I've noticed they enjoy things a lot more when they work for it. Let me see if I got any money on me. I have a deal worked with them. If I mention them, I have to pay them in the sermon. It's work, so like social influencers or something already. No, it's kind of like a gift, but I got to pay them. They make a deal because I use them all the time in illustrations that I have to pay them off a little bit, okay? It's a bribe. It's more blackmail than anything. I'm showing you not how to do it. Here you go, Emily and Paul. Emily last week cleaned the car and it looked great. And she drives the car and she cleaned the car and it looks great. And you know what I've noticed? She appreciates the car more this week because she cleaned the car, because she put some sweat there in the car. Paul really loves that basketball goal. He's out there playing all the time. Why does he love it so much? Because he worked on the basketball goal and he's taking care of the basketball goal. See, our kids, when we teach them and show them how to work, when we require them to work, allow them to share in the work. And believe me, I'm way behind because I have them do all kinds of jobs all the time. I don't pay them for, don't I, Emily? If we teach them and we show them how to work, they're going to see how wealth is built. They're going to see how ownership is made and respect is given and knowledge is discovered. It's found in something called W-O-R-K. My dad always said, I don't know if this is going to be much fun. He goes, well, it's not supposed to be fun. Work isn't spelled P-L-A-Y. Spelled W-O-R-K. Get to work. Here's my point. Everyone's called to work. Every one of you. Your children, they're called to work. Every one of them. I love your kids. I love you. I love all your families. I love that you're all called to share in the work. Many are called to work in the home, and I appreciate that so much. That's a lot of hard work to work in the home. To keep the house clean, to work on the laundry, to have meals ready. That's a lot of work. Some are called to start businesses. Others are called to a trade. Your call to work is important. If those called to be teachers don't teach, we'll have illiteracy. If those called to farm don't plant, there'll be no harvest. And there'll be starvation. If those called to be scientists don't research, we'll have disease. And if those called to law enforcement do not patrol, we'll have anarchy. If those called to be salesmen don't sell, our economy will be stagnant. And if those called to work in factories don't report to the line tomorrow morning, we will have no industry. Your daily jobs are called out partnerships with God that meet the needs of this world. Which is why Doug could tell you, work willingly at whatever you do as though you're working for the Lord rather than people. So here's the bottom line. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, if you believe that Jesus is Christ, Son of the living God, and rose from the dead, and He's your Lord and Savior, He's also your boss. And so when you go to work and you don't put in a full day's work for a full day's pay, the one you're cheating is who? When you're surfing Facebook on company time, who you cheating? God. Yeah. Get serious. Oh, man. He is meddling now. But then whenever we do a job well done, when we work hard, we don't leave till the job's done. Who are we pleasing? Pleasing the Lord. When you get up tomorrow morning, you cook your kids breakfast before they go to school, who you pleasing? Not just your kid's belly, but you're pleasing the Lord. Work as though you're working for the Lord. As Jesus traveled and preached the good news, and He healed people of all sorts of disease and illness, He looked at them and He had compassion on them. He said, they're helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. They're confused. And He told His disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest and ask Him to send more workers into the fields. Friends, the harvest is greater than ever before. Will you be a worker for God? Will you go to work for God? See, the hiring process is like this. It begins with God's work in you. That's how you get hired to work for God. That's how you get your time card. As you come and you let God's work begin in you. And we're going to go ahead and we're going to stand right now and we're going to sing. And if you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and you want to come and make Him your Lord and Him be your master and He be the one you work for, you come to the front as we sing. He'll hire you, I promise. He hired me, He'll hire you. He'll make your path straight, and He will give you a rich and satisfying life. You come as we sing. Take my blood.
Lord, we thank you for allowing us to share in the Word. We thank you that, you know, you could just automatically just make us all receive, but instead you allow us to go out and share in the work of sharing your gospel, of sharing your love. You allow us to share in the work of, in this world, to give us a purpose, to give us a rich and satisfying life. Lord, may we look at this work that's before us. May we realize that today's a day of rest, a reward for the hard work, and that tomorrow's an opportunity to go and contribute, to share in the work. So, Lord, guide us and direct us. I thank you for your favor that you've put upon us. We are yours, and now we go out into the fields. You're the Lord of the harvest. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Have a great day.